mostly developing and transitional economies are engaged in the unregulated economy. More than 10 million people are refugee or stateless and are systematically denied access to governance services. By 2025, more than 1 billion people will be working globally between nation-state jurisdictions. Pangaea allows these users to create voluntary communities, gain legal protection, make business agreements, and access governance services direct from their mobile phones.
We have 3.6 billion cell phone users on the planet, so that's roughly half of the population. 80% of the world population right now is in frontier or emerging markets, and we have 2 billion adults on the planet right now who are living unbanked, who are basically off the grid of regular governments. These people can't count on their governments to give them land titles, they're not protected in any legal way, and they're kind of operating in the gray zone between legal and illegal. Also, we have a global legal services market of $600 billion a year, tenancy rising, a billion people working regularly between different countries, and there's no jurisdiction, for example, if you're working between Germany and Brazil, or you're doing business between these two countries, or any other countries which are outside of US, like the European Union. So that's our target group. These people are currently being massively underserved by their own governments, and jurisdiction as a service is a way to provide these people with everything they need to do business and to make sure they're not getting ripped off.
Yes, as you see, the nation states, so we cannot decide what jurisdiction, we cannot decide what nation we belong to. So, particularly for these, for people in developing countries, but also for us here, it's a way to get improved, to get the governance and the jurisdiction and services, governance services, which can be much cheaper, improved, because there is an alternative. We are providing an alternative to a centralized jurisdiction.
Yeah. Because what we have right now is an oligopoly of entities who are responsible for the people who are in their territory. It's basically a global apartheid. It's not my responsibility if I was born in Germany, New Zealand, Ghana, or Russia, but I am subject to the rules that these countries put down for their citizens, and it's slightly unfair to state it in a friendly way. So, yeah.
Yes, because one of the principles of the nation is, the nation constitution is the self-determination. So each of us has the rights as a world citizen to decide for our own fate, so for its own fate. So that is, and for decide the nation belongs to, decide the law belongs to abide to, and that's why the jurisdiction is coming in the form of a tokenized technology, and it's opt-in.
So it's all the big difference is it's all voluntary. Right now, everything the government does is by force, but Bitnation is a platform to make voluntary agreements.
Yeah, so officially it's stated as opt-in peer-to-peer jurisdiction.
Okay. Oops. So our goal is to get up to 150,000 global citizens. Right now we're at 10,000. Mm-hmm. And we're aiming at getting at 150,000 over the next year.
Yes.
There's three main things you're doing with Pangaea. First of all, create peer-to-peer contracts. Peer-to-peer contracts, resolve disputes that may arise, and create and join virtual nations. So there's a market for smart contracts that already exists. You can come up with your own ones if nothing is to your liking. And if a dispute arises, there's a market
And then you can also create virtual nations and communities. Like I said before, we cannot decide our own nation, but with Deep Nation, you can create your, not yours, but a nation that is our community that puts together same members, same citizens who share the same ideas, the same beliefs. So this is also a great enhancement to the self-determination of the world citizens. So then we go through the Nigerian jurisdiction platform and its structure.
Exactly. So we have three pillars of the whole thing. First of all, we have the code of law, so the rules that apply. Second of all, we have arbitration, so judging whether these rules were followed or not. And third of all, we have enforcement. And in all three pillars, you have three different categories of options which you can choose. First of all, is from a menu. So you can follow, for example, common law or some other law, Sharia law, for example, or some other law that has been developed. You can follow what's already there. If that's not what applies to your contract, you can come up with something else, or you can choose existing national law, an example, state of Delaware law. For arbitration, it's again the same. You can choose from a menu. You can have, for example, DAPs with crowd juries or other ways to resolve this. Again, it's a market. Everybody's free to come up with solutions how to do arbitration as efficient and good as possible, or again, you can choose standing courts. For enforcement, the basis of it all are the reputation tokens. So if you fulfill a contract and get reputation tokens, which are calculated by RAI, if you don't, you don't get any. So you can already there see how trustworthy a partner is, but obviously if that's not enough for you, there's possibilities to make bespoke enforcement mechanisms which you can write into the contract.
So the contract, the contract factions. So we'll see first of all how is the process of the contract. First we're vetting the counterparts.
Yeah, so which basically means you're not allowed to be a U.S. citizen, unfortunately, because they like to extend their reach over their countries, but that's right now the only knockout criteria, which is bad.
Then you can generate a smart contract. So you imagine two counterparts that agree in a privately, voluntarily on a contract, maybe a marriage contract or a sale, property sale, everything that can be privately agreed upon.
Yeah, so you go through the choices that were just laid out in the last slide, choosing your code of law, choosing your arbitrators.
If you witness, then you finally sign the contract, and then the contract can be notarized through the public notary services, which has been developed by Deep Nation and has been mutuated also by the Republic of Estonia.
Yeah.
And then if something goes wrong, there is also the possibility to create an escrow and resolve the dispute through always the jurisdiction that can be chosen, the
lot more things plugging into that in the future. Anything that applies to jurisdiction as a service can be done. Yeah, even insurance and other things that are which you would call big government today, basically, like health insurance, is even a seed insurance that somebody did already. So if you wanted, you could set up a health insurance over that. There's no reason you couldn't do things that are social over this platform. It's not just the capitalist functions of government.
So the smart contract, if it's not here, are in the PR are managed by the Pangea arbitration token, which is based on the Ethereum technology. For the moment,
We're working on having a blockchain agnostic in the future. Right now, it's running on Ethereum, but that's where we're starting. And so most of it is Ethereum right now. Our reputation tokens is done by Pangea itself. They're issued by our artificial intelligence, depending on how the smart contract, what it looks like. So that stops people from just entering into contracts which are very easy to fulfill, artificially jack up their reputation scores, and then screw somebody over. So the artificial intelligence gives a certain amount of reputation tokens depending on what the contract is, so that there's no human, so that we don't go into like this Black Mirror world where it's like a population contest, popularity contest, or something like that.
And the network, it was decided to use a Tantalus mesh network, which is delay tolerant mesh protocol, particularly for developing countries where sometimes the network is not so stable and steady. And so this can help, particularly if we think that in these countries, most of the smartphones we use.
Yeah.
So,
internet is not something you can take for granted. So, yeah, for these markets, obviously, it's very important to be able to work offline or not always online. So
we see that we are not the only one that has thought of providing jurisdiction as a service, but certainly we are the one that has the most complete features. If you see here, mediate, literate, and modular crowd jury, we can provide a chat for the citizens. It is decentralized, it is encrypted, there is an arbitration market, it's based on reputation.
Which is very important, obviously.
Yes, and then the smart contracts, as we say, we provide them, and it's open source. Not all these other competitors, but it's not competitors, we maybe that we can work together. So, now, we are talking about something that is still in progress. And so, here is a development roadmap that we want to stick to. So, we are in the first portal, at the end, you can already have, we have the app, and we can have donations, and there is a chat. And then, next, we will implement the arbitration, the Lucy bot, which is very important for the reputation, for scoring the reputation of citizens, smart contract, public companies, and the code of law. So, okay, we are basically, this is the cadence, the rhythm of the sprints. It's about, in 3 weeks, there is always new features.